I don't think I need a microphone. I'm used to talking to students in a loud voice. So I think this that'll work. And I'm not very good with microphones anyway. So let me introduce myself. My name is Anthony Ucci. I'm the Associate Vice President for Academic Affairs. As you may have heard Megan say, I was also the Department Chair of Engineering for many years before that. And have worked with Megan on a number of different initiatives, and very pleased to be a champion of STEM programs here at the college. It's an essential part of BCC's mission to serve local industry, and one of the areas where, unfortunately, we're not fully meeting our mission is that serving STEM industries. And the fact is, we're not serving our mission fully because there are all sorts of different opportunities in various STEM fields that aren't being filled by local individuals. The fact is, across America, we don't produce enough STEM graduates to meet the demands of STEM fields, which is an opportunity for all of you. The fact is, if you do go into a STEM field, there's a huge demand and huge opportunity there. And one of the nice things about having local people here is they can talk about local jobs. I mean, these are jobs that are right in your region, and I think they'll tell you a great deal about how satisfying they are and about how some of your perceptions or concepts about STEM employment might be a little different from the environment that they've experienced. I've worked with many of these individuals. I've had Dell in my class. I think, at least a CAD class, I believe.
CAD and material science.
Material science also, okay. So it's been some wonderful collaborations over the years. And what I really hope you get out of today's experience is to understand a little bit more about what it's like to be someone who works in a technical field, and about how satisfying that job can be, and you know how great those opportunities there. And I also encourage you to do one other thing. We can practice it right now. Can anyone do this? Go, stretch real high. Okay, can you do it? Okay. So you probably haven't used that arm very much, but today you're gonna get an opportunity to ask questions. So I encourage you to definitely take advantage of it. You have some wonderful people in the field here, great experiences. Take advantage, ask questions. And for those people who are not BC students, BCC students, welcome to the college, and another opportunity you have today, because we have a number of different STEM educators here between Megan and Mary and Bob, is to ask questions about the BCC programs associated with some of these opportunities. So please take advantage. But lastly, I really want to thank all of these individuals. The fact is, we can do a good job in the classroom, but we really can't tell you exactly what it's like to be in all these different jobs. So we try regularly to bring in people who are working in the field to talk about what's going on in that field and what the current demands are, because it's exciting and it's always changing. And so having somebody who has that direct experience is extremely important. So thank you so much for helping us out and providing that function that we really can't do. And I'm looking forward to hearing what all of you have to say. And now I'll turn it back over to Megan.
Well, again, thank you everybody for coming. And this is our first of five STEM panels we're going to be hosting over the course of this year. And our panel today is going to focus on environmental, science, and technology. And really, it's a very diverse group of individuals that we have here today. So I really do encourage you, as you listen, jot down some questions. If you want to know more about what they're doing, about what's happening in their particular industry, in their particular career field, or even their path that got them here today. Those are really important. Many students today really feel that their path is very linear from what they're going to do in college to what they're going to do when they go out to work. And I think today you're going to hear from individuals who tell you that their path wasn't linear. It went in very many different ways, and maybe ways they weren't even anticipating when they first started. Secondly, we're going to go through today, and I want to encourage you, as Anthony just said, to ask questions. So we'll do two speakers at a time, and then we're going to stop and ask questions. So I really want to encourage you to think about those questions as our first two speakers are going on. Then we'll do the next two speakers. We'll finish off with Chris Jakubiak at the end of the table there. Sorry, Chris, you're last but not least. And then we'll open the questions back up to the full group. Finally, the last thing I want to encourage everybody to think about is this is a great opportunity to network. So if you hear something here today where you want to know more about that industry or that individual, after the program today, we're going to be here for a while longer talking to students and talking among ourselves. Take this opportunity to come down, introduce yourself, find out a little bit more. Networking is incredibly important in today's job market. You're going to meet many different people, and how you meet them, where you meet them, and when they learn about what your passion is, they're going to remember those sorts of things, that when you are then out looking for a job, they're going to remember, oh, I met Johnny over at, or I met Mary at this event, and she was really interested in the wind energy or what we were talking about. She had a lot of passion. I'd love to, you know, talk with her in more detail. Or you might find you can do an informational interview with one of these individuals. Informational interviews are great ways to learn about an industry, to learn about that job, and to learn more about how you can make yourself more marketable when you're going out there in the field. So I just plant those little nuggets today as something to keep in the back of your mind. Going up and talking to people, it's not scary. All these individuals, very nice, very open to talking with everybody here. They've given up their time today because they want you to hear about what they're doing, and they want you to become excited and engaged and want to ask more questions. So I'm just going to do a quick introduction of who our panel is today, but I'm really going to let them go into more detail about themselves. So our first panelist is Brian, and I have to put my glasses on, sorry. Brian Bragginton-Smith, he's the president and CEO of Aquagen Infrastructure Systems. He's going to tell you a lot about that company and what they're doing, but a lot more about what he's been doing in his career over the past 20 or 30 years. Next to Brian is Linton Harrington. Linton Harrington is the Youth and Workforce Development Program Manager at the Trustees of Reservation. He's going to talk about his experience and how he came into doing what he does today. Next to him is Tanya Lewandowski. Tanya works with NOAA, and she's a fishery biologist. And again, you have all their information on these yellow sheets, so you can read in more detail about them. Next to Tanya is Del Thurston. He is a graduate of BCC in our program, and he works for Veolia Water in the wastewater treatment plant. And Chris Jakubiak is also a BCC adjunct faculty for us. And he is now currently working for MassDOT, but prior to MassDOT, he also worked for UMass Dartmouth and their School of Marine and Science Technology. So he's going to talk about his work in both locations and what he's been doing in those fields. The last thing I want to leave you all with, too, is that, as Anthony mentioned, we have quite a few programs here at BCC that focus on environmental sciences, environmental technology. We have our new life sciences program, and that's where you will find our environmental sciences program, and that's a great way to jumpstart your program, your career. You can do your first 2 years here at BCC, and then continue on at any state university or college or even private institution here in Massachusetts, as well as anywhere else outside of the country. But we also have two-year technology programs, engineering technology, environmental technology. We also have wastewater treatment certificates. These are all great programs, and if you want to talk about any of those after the event today, we are happy to talk with you. Mary Cass, if you want to raise your hand. Mary is one of our faculty. She teaches in our automation and manufacturing, so she'd be happy to talk with you about what she does. Bob Rack over here in the front. Bob is our environmental technology instructor. Bob also recently received a National Science Foundation grant that is focused on wastewater and drinking water and other issues around water technologies. So he will also be happy to talk with you about where he's going with that this coming in the next couple of years. But with that, I'd really like to get us going with our speakers. So our first speaker is going to be Brian. And again, if you guys feel comfortable, you may sit there, or you're more than welcome to come up and speak at the podium.
I'll come up to the podium just because I'm a bit nervous. In contemplating coming in here and talking to you today, my thought process was different from where I'm going to go with this because of some of the introductory comments that were made. It's mostly going to be sort of focused on STEM and time. Because if right now you're not thinking, okay, I'm envisioning what my world is going to be like 15 years from now, then you're not getting yourself ready for where you got to be. Because time just continually goes on. If you are focused on what is now, you're going to get there 15 years from now, and you're going to be too late. Now, I can say this because my experience track has been one of sort of keeping a level of controllable panic. And what I'm referring to is my particular proclivity is entrepreneurial in nature. In other words, I look at things and kind of see different ways to do things. And it's innovative. So those two things put together are things that move our society forward. And the reason I say this is because in my background, 20 years ago, actually closer to 30 years ago, I began working in alternative resource development. My two areas of focus were water and energy, and the reason I chose those is because I did just what I asked you guys to do a couple of minutes ago. I projected where I thought we might be 15 years from where I was, and I saw a world where we were going to be challenged from a standpoint of our energy supply and water supply. Well, it turns out I was somewhat right. Initially, we engaged in conservation, which is reducing the usage, and then transitioned into full-blown alternative resource development. On the energy side, I came up with this concept called ocean ranching, which is the integration of offshore renewable energy with sustainable aquaculture as a platform dynamic. That turned into Cape Wind shortly after which I left the company, and it is taking its course. But it's my assertion that one needs to look at integrated platform dynamics in that environment in order to be able to really succeed. The energy path has also included wind energy, and I was engaged in wind energy here in Massachusetts back in the early 90s, and that industry basically I started on land. And basically was told to get off the land because people didn't really want them in their backyard. So I went offshore. At that time, the first offshore wind farm was being developed off of Vindeby in the Netherlands. And as I looked at it, I thought, they're building these concrete caissons, and that's supporting the wind turbine. That's an antiseptic kind of a design. Why don't they just build a little bit of feature into that and turn the thing into an artificial reef? Now you've got biological activity. There's a value proposition associated with it. Here's where the controlled panic comes in. So at that point, began looking at aquaculture as an opportunity. And you know, sort of like the ball and the pinball machine, I went, we came up with something, another thing, and it ended up developing into offshore cage culture development and deployment in concert with renewable energy. That was the Ocean Ranch. We got to the starting gate, and at that point in time, there were no regulations to allow that to happen. There was no aquaculture industry to speak of in the United States, and no one had ever cited an offshore renewable energy platform except for wave energy conversion. And so the statutes and the regulations were very clear and very restrictive. So in essence, we couldn't get there from here. Since that time, regulations have been put into place, and now we're seeing a robust level of activity in the offshore wind environment. So that's on that energy side. On the water side, we began with flow restrictors and that sort of stuff to reduce usage. We transitioned into looking at alternative water resource development. What we identified was that you could filter water, remove the organic pollutants, and create an alternative water resource. So we focused on that technology, introduced the membrane bioreactor technology to our region up here, which is now actually 15 or 20 years after we started, has become one of the primary technologies that is being applied in our coastal water purification and cleaning up of wastewater. Since that point, I also obviously have been involved in ocean science and in engineering, and have been studying algae as a systemic issue associated with the coastal waters. We began looking at it and thinking, well, geez, you know, this algae stuff is really a problem. It's moving in and pushing out the eelgrass, and you know, that's a really important fish habitat. So what do we do about it? Again, you start on a path asking a question, and you know that really ends up bringing you to new opportunities and scenarios. And basically, the algae led us to the fact that it is not an invasive species as we had assumed. It's more of an opportunist. If there is a vacancy, they'll move in. And so the eelgrass was dying, but the eelgrass was dying as a result of the increased nutrient levels. Those nutrient levels are actually toxic to eelgrass. So that's the reason these things were becoming available, and that's where your algae was coming from. If you looked at the algae and as it came about, started off with the stuff you typically see at a cleaner beach, and that's with the ulva, enteromorpha, the green leafy stuff that ends up in the rack line. As the conditions deteriorate, different algae will move in and take over. For the most part, that is facilitated by the proliferation of microalgae. Now, microalgae is kind of interesting stuff. Mother Nature uses it, A, to balance the atmospheric gas ratios, and B, to remove nutrients from coastal waters. And in its role as a coastal water cleanup mechanism, it's extremely effective. Basically, microalgae is a tiny little plant, and it's part of the planktonic species that live in our oceans. In fact, right now, we're sitting here breathing oxygen as 20% of our atmospheric composition. That oxygen, 40% of that was created by marine algae that are floating around out there in the sea. Without that, we'd be in trouble. In fact, if you look at those algae species over billions of years, they converted our atmosphere from one that was, in the beginning, methane, CO2, you know, sort of nasty stuff, doesn't keep organic life like us alive, to one that has a high oxygen content, and it helps to maintain it. Anyway, looking at this, we initially thought that the algae was a problem. What we recognized was that it had the ability to help us. So by capturing it, utilizing it in wastewater, we found that by utilizing microalgae, we could remove the nutrients from the water to levels that are unreachable by mechanical systems. As a result of that, we started using algae as a methodology, testing it in our laboratories. You can't really see them. My hands actually got really messed up because I was using this algae in a laboratory setting. We were using well water, adding nutrients and growing the stuff. So my thinking was that, well, it shouldn't have anything harmful in it. We're just using well water. Well, my hands were telling me something different. It took me a while to figure it out. But what I finally sort of realized is that they were oxidizing. So I looked at the process and realized, well, when you have a ray of sunlight hits an algae organism, it penetrates, it hits the chloroplast, which is the green material in a plant that allows it to do photosynthesis. When that trigger happens, that plant just does photosynthesis. Basically, it uptakes nutrients, it uptakes other elements. It uptakes carbon, which it gets from CO2, converts those into sugars so that it can live and reproduce, and it breathes out pure oxygen. Well, what was happening is in our photobioreactor where we grow our algae, the algae is contained, so that oxygen's got nowhere to go. So I threw a DO meter into the tank, and that DO meter, which I had used in coastal water quality monitoring, and I'd never seen it get up over, say, 12 parts per million, which was in an environment where you had algae, where you had sunlight, so it was doing its photosynthetic thing. When I dropped that probe into that tank, it started out at 8.5, which was atmospheric saturation, and it climbed. It went to 12.5, it went to 22.5, it went to 36.5, it finally topped out at about 48. At that point, this water was 700% supersaturated with pure oxygen. Oxidized my hands. So once we realized that, we looked at it and thought there's got to be a value proposition here. It turns out that what we're talking about now is wastewater. The wastewater that we all need to deal with on a daily basis, the most important element in treating wastewater is oxygen. It allows for the bacteria to digest the organic material and make it benign. The key for that process is oxygen, which is an aerobic process. Normally this is supplied by blowers, and they use atmospheric air, blow it into the liquid, gives it the ability to digest. What we realized is that by capturing that algae's ability to produce oxygen and bringing it around to the front side of the treatment process and inserting it at the right place, you're able to eliminate the need for that. This creates a system that is now just dependent on that little algae, and it's taking care of our wastewater. So this all relates to STEM, because this is hands-on stuff. This is science and technology being applied to solve our problems. Every single one of you in this room has the capacity to be able to participate in this industry in a myriad of ways. What I would suggest to you right now is that your real working environment is going to be out a decade. And don't expect it to be comprised of what you think it's going to be today. Because I will tell you one thing that is a constant, and that is change. And that change can either be your friend or your enemy, depending upon how you adapt to it. So some of that adaptation is innovation, and I hope that you guys continue on your path. There is a tremendous range of different things you are going to be able to do, from operations and logistics to the real science and trying to push the edge of the envelope. But it takes you. It takes something that you're all here with, and that's passion. And it takes the courage to apply that passion to that dream. And in the end, that makes for a successful future. Thank you.
So as I mentioned, we're going to go to our second speaker. And then after our second speaker, we're going to come back and ask questions. So don't lose those questions that you might have for Ryan and Linton, if you'd like to go.
Okay, thank you. So my name's Linton Harrington. I thought I'd start off by just telling you a little bit about what I do, and then I'll tell you kind of how I got here. So I work for an organization called the Trustees, which is a nonprofit land conservation organization. Basically, it's actually one of the biggest nonprofits in Massachusetts. It has about 250 full-time employees. We have 116 properties all over Massachusetts. Everything from mountains to beaches. We have working farms, we have forests, historic houses with formal gardens. So we have a huge variety of different landscapes that we care for. And so having a big staff, we hire people who do everything from property management, keeping the grass cut and keeping the trails open. We have ecologists who study the plants and animals that we have on our properties and make sure that we're protecting rare and endangered species. We have land conservation specialists who understand the laws around buying property and land conservation. And then we have people like myself who do a lot of education. And I worked for the Trustees for about 12 years. I was an education coordinator, so I was leading a lot of nature programs, everything from bird walks to mushroom walks, teaching people about the natural history of the landscapes that we care for. And really, sort of the ultimate goal of that work is getting people, you know, outside, enjoying nature, learning about the ecology and the environmental science of our area and why we need to protect these beautiful properties. And what I do right now, for the past couple of years, I've worked as the Youth and Workforce Development Manager. And as part of that job, I run a Youth Conservation Corps program. And so I'll give a plug for that. I know there's some high school students here. We actually hire 16 to 18-year-olds, primarily in the summer, to do outdoor environmental work. So we're building trails, we're planting trees, we're doing cedar swamp restoration. We work in community gardens, doing sustainable agriculture. So if you're interested in that type of work, we have jobs that are available. And for college students, we hire supervisors and assistant supervisors to run these crews in the summertime. So it's a great way to get some experience, be outside, and really learn about some of these environmental issues that are facing our community. So how did I end up doing this work? Well, I guess for me, it started off when I was still a kid, and I really just liked being outside. I would spend my summers sort of exploring the forests, going to summer camp. Just for me, the outdoors was just a place to go and have fun. And I really wasn't that interested in the science of nature and the environment. In fact, as a kid, I kind of thought that, you know, studying something would kind of take away just the wonder and the beauty of nature. That if, you know, scientists, they tend to like pick things apart, you break it down, reduce it to its little pieces, and then you study those little tiny pieces. And for me, when I was a kid, I felt like, you know, I'd rather just appreciate sort of the whole, and just enjoy the outdoors as a fun place without having to sort of pick it apart and study it. But I think, you know, for me, as my evolution in my career, I've come to realize that actually understanding the incredible complexity of how the environment works actually gives me a greater sense of wonder. And, you know, taking a walk through the woods and realizing that there's all these chemical and biological processes happening on scales that I can't even imagine, and like even just understanding like the little bit that we do understand and realizing how much more there is that we really don't understand, that to me just gives you an even greater appreciation for nature and for being outside. So anyway, I worked this, you know, through high school and college. I worked as a camp counselor. I was leading backpacking trips and whitewater canoeing trips. Again, just kind of having fun, not really thinking that you could actually make a career doing environmental work. When I was in college, back in the early 90s, there really was no environmental science. The closest you could do was to take a major in biology, and you know, the class you'd have to take was cellular biology, or people called it cell hell, and you basically spent your afternoons in a laboratory. Which again, for me, like I was all about the outdoors. I didn't want to spend my college years, you know, in a lab doing like 3-4 hour labs. So I actually in college I majored in psychology. I didn't even do a science degree as an undergrad. But when I got out of school, I was interested in teaching. I had worked with kids as a camp counselor, and so I actually worked as a science teacher. Even though I didn't have a degree in science, I was able to somehow talk my way into a science teaching job at an independent school. So unlike the public schools, you didn't have to have your certification and all of that. And I realized that I really did like teaching, but again, it was the whole indoor thing. I didn't like being in a classroom and kids walking into the classroom thinking like, oh, school is boring, the teacher is like the enemy, and we're gonna, you know, give the teacher a hard time. But if you said, hey, today we're going outside, then that suddenly everybody was excited and interested. So I was like, you know, and if you want to teach about the environment, you should be out in the field. That's where I wanted to be. So I decided that environmental education might actually be a job for me. And I think a lot of people, including members of my family, were like, yeah, so, but when are you going to get a real job? You know, like, taking kids out into the woods, that's great, you know, if you want to be a camp counselor in high school, but, you know, you have to actually make a living here. So I realized I probably did need a science degree if I was going to go into science education and environmental education. So I went back to school and got my master's degree in environmental studies. And again, you know, by this point, environmental science had become more of an actual thing, and I think I was realizing that it's not just about working in a lab. There's a lot of opportunities to do field work as well. Whether you're working as a scientist or an educator, you don't have to be sitting in a lab all day. So after I finished my graduate degree, I was definitely interested in, you know, getting a job working outside. I wasn't so interested in going back into a classroom setting, but I was interested in working for a nonprofit, and I think that's another important thing for me was I wanted to work for an organization that was mission-based, that really was trying to serve some higher goal. The idea of going to work for a company and just working to help increase profits for a company, I wasn't really about making money, but of course you have to make money, and kind of the irony of working for a nonprofit is you still have to think about money a lot because you're always fundraising and writing grants. Unfortunately, it's kind of unavoidable, but for me, I definitely wanted to know that the work I was doing was really serving some higher goal rather than just trying to make money for a corporation. So I was lucky enough to actually get my job with the trustees working here in Fall River. Some of you might be familiar with the Freetown State Forest and Copacut Woods, which is part of this 14,000 acre called the Bioreserve. And so I was able to get a job doing education programs right here in Fall River. I think another interesting thing about my work is I tend to work with a lot of urban residents. The program that I run is really focused on urban settings and realizing that when it comes to the environmental movement as a whole, we tend to forget about the cities, which are really some of the places where the biggest environmental impacts are happening. Urban residents are facing issues of, you know, air pollution, water pollution, and they often have the least access to open space and the outdoors. But really, it's people living in the cities, that's where, you know, more and more our population is becoming urban. And we need to focus on people living in the cities and making sure that we're educating the urban residents about environmental issues and how it impacts their communities and building those connections. I think for me, another piece with science education itself, it can be a lot about facts and kind of getting into the weeds of the chemistry and the biology, but why do people care about this stuff? Like, to me, as an educator, it's going beyond just teaching facts and statistics and things like that, but getting to the heart of why it matters, why do we care about this stuff, and how does it impact our daily lives? So, for all of you, I would just, you know, encourage you to pursue your opportunities. I know for me, getting experience working in the field, whether it's through internships, through volunteering, working outside the classroom and getting experience, in the field, getting to know people that are working in the field and talking to people about what their interests are and how they got there. So I think it's great that you all came today to hear from the panelists about sort of our journeys and how we got here. But that's a little bit about my background. That's it, thanks.
Great. I love it. Do I already have a question up there? All right, just one thing. When you ask your question, I'm gonna repeat it so they can get it on video, and then we'll ask the individual to respond. So your question, please.
For both of the speakers, I would like to ask, how do you hire mycologists, and for what purpose?
So your question is, do you hire college students?
Mycologists.
Mycologists, okay. Do you hire mycologists, and for what purposes?
Well, I know for for the trustees, we do, you know, I've done mushroom walks, and so we've used mycologists to lead some of the walks that we do. This is actually a great time of year to go out and look for mushrooms. There's some incredible diversity in, you know, the fungus world. So I don't think we have any specific mycologists on staff, but for things like specific programs, or our ecology staff would hire someone to go out and do maybe like a mushroom survey on our property so we know what's out there.
Well, I'm gonna answer you in the abstract because I think it's the most appropriate. If you look at what's going on right now, you know, kind of what I've been talking about doing, really all I'm really kind of doing is kind of watching what Mother Nature does and figuring out, you know, how to make that kind of a reality of what we do. And if you look at that particular field of endeavor, and you look at the research that's being done now on the life of trees and the interrelatedness of all of these different species and the overall dynamic of how life works, that particular area with the critically important job that fungus does of transferring important elements back and forth between the trees, which seem to have some kind of a symbiotic relationship. I believe that this is one of those things that is commonly referred to as a paradigm shift. What that really means is that we as a species are transitioning between a time where we had this attitude of dominion over nature, and that the only answer to everything was something more mechanically sophisticated and sort of contrary to the natural dynamic. What we're, I think, seeing now, and it's because we're driven to by resource shortages and global warming and climate change, is that we need to become stewards of the earth. To do that, we have to understand, and we have to look towards that 15-year point. If we don't do this stuff, and if you don't sort of look at this as an opportunity to try to help make these things happen, then we as a community and as a society are going to be in trouble. But I think that this particular discussion, that particular question, is germane, because I believe that there's a great potential field of opportunity as some of this discussion matures and, you know, in truth becomes part of the reality of our world 15 years hence.
Thank you. Do we have anybody else?
Good morning, everybody. I have a question for Brian. Can you tell me a little bit more about noble gas, and what do you detect? What do you detect oxygen? Then what do you do that oxygen? Do you use oxygen in the lab or something like that?
So let me see if I can just capture that real quick. So you asked about the noble gas.
Noble gas.
And then how do you capture?
When you determine the oxygen, when you find the oxygen from waste, wastewater or something like that. So how do you use this oxygen in any certain way, or in the lab, or in the hospital, or something like that?
And how do you use oxidation?
Well, you know, there again, you know, kind of abstract, kind of open-ended, but the fact is that we're just kind of getting our arms around the mysterious nature of this, and the fact that you know, when you're talking about 100% supersaturated, that's kind of cool. But when you're talking about 700, 800% supersaturated with pure oxygen, now you've got something there. Now how we are using that presently is in order to eliminate mechanical systems and energy costs associated with treating wastewater. That's a natural flow, you know, kind of, no pun intended, but that's kind of the first progression. But true progress and true opportunity happens when you apply your mental capacities and your inquisitiveness to this question. And it might just be that because you are who you are and you are where you are, that ends up becoming something that becomes a fundamental component of helping to bring this whole dynamic forward. So I would encourage all of you that it's in the hands-on application and the intuitive
insight that you'll develop in really focusing on what you're trying to accomplish that'll bring this stuff about. But these are both open-ended opportunities, and even if we're just sitting here kind of saying, well, you know, this is interesting, you know, here I am, you know, sort of a sophomore in college, and I think this is where I want to go, but I'm not really sure, don't sweat it, because your reality is going to lead you where you're going to end up being. But I will tell you that the smallest element of something that you learned sitting in one of these classes can one day become the most important piece of knowledge that you could find, because it happens to be the piece that fits into that effort, and that's what's going to make this whole exciting opportunity, and maybe some of the questions that you might have right now about how does this turn into value for me, that's part of that. And I wanted to say one other thing, and that's the what we are, the non-traditional students, because I would throw into that category something that we all have to grab, and that is that you have to be a student for the rest of your life, because that's where the growth is going to happen, that's where the opportunities rest. This is a channel that you're establishing right now that is going to be available to you forever. And this is an institution which is going to be able to provide you with the opportunity for the resources forever. So you have to look at it that way.
Great. We will be able to take more questions at the end, so I am going to move it along in time, and I'm going to ask Tanya if she would come up and do her presentation. Thank you.
Great.
I'm a walker. I can't sit still.
Is this on?
Yes.
Okay, so my name is Tanya Lewandowski. I work as a fisheries biologist for the National Marine Fisheries Service. It's one of the services found within NOAA, so I'm not going to talk about the weather service, but they're there too. So I thought also, after listening to the other presentations, what I'd probably tell you is to kind of what my day is like, my month is like, my year might be like, and then kind of how I got there. And I'm very non-traditional in my educational background and very non-linear in many ways and life experiences. So what my position currently is I'm the lead instructor or lead for all the instruction that ATSI observers actually go through. We have a program actually here at BCC that assists with some ATSI monitor programs, certificate programs, so I had to put the plug in for that as well. And what these observers do, they're from Maine, North Carolina, is their operational area, and they actually go on commercial fishing vessels and they collect fishery-dependent data. This information then is brought back, it's edited, audited, and it goes into a huge Oracle database that's actually used in conjunction with some of the research and science survey work, and that kind of helps counts and helps with management, helps with sustainable fisheries. It also helps other species such as marine mammals, turtles, and all the poster children that one would see on a lot of the programs that you hear about being a marine biologist. So I'm sometimes you think of the Jacques Cousteau kind of life as being a marine biologist, and sometimes I'm sitting behind my box in the office and plugging and chugging and doing budgets and things like that, and it makes me very sad. But then there's other times that I'm really happy that I had that type of opportunity, because now I'm able to apply all of the science towards a real, actual, like, motion, action. I'm also a deep sea coral specialist, very excited, just got back from International Symposium on deep sea coral work. You may have also heard, we just had the president just signed in a new monument recently that's just offshore. So there's a lot of different work that's being done there. So it's being able to take that kind of diverse, being able to do the budget work, being able to be kind of a leader when you have a team that's working with you, and being able to actually apply that to real-time science. Fisheries need to be sustainable. I'm sure we've all read and heard about some of the issues that are happening. Obviously, our environment is changing, and we need to be able to kind of promote those sustainability options, I would think. So one day I might be doing that. The next day I might be going out on a survey on a research vessel for a couple of weeks. Sometimes I might be out with one of my students or a group of my students on a training commercial fishing vessel, and we're out there picking the catch, doing fish ID, taking out age samples, then taking these age samples back to the lab and working them up for further research. So there's a lot of difference, a big diverse kind of day that one can have. And then I have the opportunity, which is one of my favorite things, is actually to work with different educational outreach programs. It's very much like this opportunity here to work with STEM students. This summer, I'm going to put another opportunity too, and we talked about networking. And that is absolutely important for you to do. Take these opportunities when there are summer internships. We have high school programs. We have cooperative programs with marine biological labs, with Woods Hole Oceanographic, and anything. You could be an engineer. You could do wind work. You're doing deep sea submersibles. Just had some people come over and we looked at the Alvin and some other ROV work that we've been working on for some of the Okeanos Explorer deep sea canyons that we're working in. So there's tons of outreach and tons of opportunities that you can have, and you meet and work with these scientists, whether it be we work everything from middle school, high school interns, as well as college interns. And a lot of these are paid positions. So definitely take those opportunities, meet with those people, and that'll help kind of guide you as to what's really kind of interest to you. I thought when I started, I was going to save the world. I was a biologist, in my mind, always. A little bit of a tomboy, like to be out in the woods, digging around, finding dead things, dragging them home, made my parents cry. And I decided, no, I'm really going to make them happy. I'm going to be a geneticist. So I had this wonderful epiphany. I decided I'm going to go to WPI, which is Polytechnic Institute. And my parents saw the bill, and they said, you shall not go to WPI at this point in time. So I went to a state college, obtained a bunch of grants, worked also with my parents, were very helpful too, so that I could eventually matriculate into WPI, and I was able to graduate there, sitting in my lab with my coat on, with my little centrifuge, and that was great. So I graduated, I'm off into the big world. I had this position working with a research group with the National Kidney Foundation out of the Medical Center in Shrewsbury, right outside of Worcester. So I'm ready to go. I got the coat, I've got the degree. 3 months later, I thought I was going to jump out of the top floor window because I couldn't stand it. So my parents were really impressed with the fact that they had assisted me with this degree that I was no longer going to use. But you do use it. We'll go back to STEM. You know, I had a heck of a good foundation of science, physics, math. I had that. I had that basis. So where am I going to go from then? Made my parents again very proud because I became a skydiving instructor. I tried to explain to my parents it was a physics thing. After 1,000 jumps, I decided this was kind of a short career. So decided to continue on, actually started working in water quality. Worked at a wastewater facility and actually ran the laboratories at a tertiary facility. So I was enjoying that. I was going back towards my environmental ways. I had to get away from the lab coats. I had to be outside. I had to do my thing too. Then I decided to pursue a master's degree. Went to UMass Amherst. They had a wonderful fisheries and wildlife program at the time. And now I was going to go save the ungulates. So I was going to do ungulate behavior. I was going to chase the wildebeest through the savannah. And there must be at least 1,000, 2,000 jobs out there for that, right? There were not. I did make it to Africa, and I watched them migrate. And then that was the end of my grant. And never would I see another time. So that wasn't great planning on my part. But again, great experience. I knew I liked working. I liked working my hands. I knew I wanted to kind of apply the science. I loved applied science. So I came back, and I told my advisor, this isn't going to work out. He said, of course not. I said, oh, yeah. So what am I going to be? He goes, well, you're always in the water. You love marine biology. You go to all the lectures. Why aren't you pursuing this? Oh, yeah. A good idea. So I decided to continue on. Then I was really interested is why people made decisions. So these two things, why are people making decisions? How does policy actually evolve for in a wildlife or environmental type of scenario? And so I started thinking about at-sea observing, and I started thinking about fisheries enforcement and so forth. And I'm like, well, how about enforcement? I don't know anything about enforcement. So I got a job as a police dispatcher, and I thought, this is good. I'm going to do that at night. I'm going to go to school during the day. It's my master's. And then they said, well, we kind of like you. I said, that's good. And I said, would you like to go to the police academy? I said, sure. Went off to the police academy. My parents are very, very upset at this point. They're like, could you just stop and slow down and then focus? And I, but
I am focusing. You just don't see the big picture yet. Mine's a little broader vision, but I'm focusing. So I decided, all right, I worked as a police officer for several years, actually, putting myself through college, which is great because I actually was able to finish my master's without any bills. I thought that was a miracle. But I was also back to networking, back to looking at of opportunities that are out there. I actually was able to become one of the NOAA students that had a whole bunch of it was a program called CEMER at the time. It was a cooperative education program. And they would work with master's students and help them develop, help them go to international fisheries conferences and societies, learn how to communicate, learn how to do presentations, learn how to take all these little numbers and things that the scientists put together and apply it to real life. So that was another great opportunity. So I put all these things together. My master's work was trying to look at enforcement of fisheries work in the New England area. And then I had another great idea, because I seemed to be on a roll at this point, and I joined the Coast Guard. So I'm gonna go to sea, and I'm gonna be an officer in the Coast Guard. So off I went, never even got to walk through my graduation. They did mail me my degree, so I know it's real. And off I went to a ship. I worked in Alaska for a couple of years as a deck watch officer. I was a boarding officer. And of course, we did life and safety at sea. After that, I was stationed here at Otis at Cape Cod. And I stood up and I was the executive officer for the Fisheries and Law Enforcement Training Center. Now, I can actually see a trend. And I was very proud to tell my parents this. Look, I'm a scientist, I'm a fisheries person, I work in law enforcement, and I'm able to apply to all in one job. So they thought that was a great idea. And then I went ice skating one day, broke my tib, fib, my ankle, and that was the end of that career. So I said, now what am I gonna do? Fortunately, when I went through officer candidate school, I was able to enroll into a program that you could pay into and go back to college later. So fortunately, I then went on to University of Rhode Island, worked on my PhD on the Marine Affairs Department. Now everything's starting to focus. I'm just, I'm way out there jumping out of airplanes, and all of a sudden I'm kind of thinking, okay, science, good foundation, moving forward, kind of like the policy, likes to see how it's actually applied to real life, what are you gonna do with it? So after 3 years of pursuing that, I was offered a position that I work with right now with NOAA, which I think is a fantastic opportunity, and I feel very blessed to have that. So, and my parents are really happy now too, because it's a full-time job, and I'm staying in one place, I bought a house and everything, so everything's nice and together. But really, those type of things, again, we'll keep going back to trying to network, looking at opportunities that are out there. They really are out there. And when you get those times just to talk to people and see where they came from, how they got there, which turns they took, how many walls they went into, broke into, knowing that the white lab coat wasn't for me either, but I made that false start, but I knew it was science. So where I fell in that whole regime, I had to kind of experience. I always worked in between my degrees, and I would highly recommend you take those opportunities too, because it's just gonna make you a more rounded and person that's gonna be very valuable for the future.
Thank you. Next up we have Del.
My name is Del Thurston. I'm a 2010 graduate of BCC here in civil engineering technology. So my interest in environmental stuff, like Linton, as a kid, I grew up right by the Lees River in Somerset. And it was fascinating for me seeing the changing bait fish throughout the summer season. At low tide, I would be picking up rocks. And looking at it now, I mean, that was a big part of my interest in ecology and now the career that I have in wastewater treatment. I wasn't much of a student in high school. I was accepted at Bridgewater State College. I lasted like one dismal semester. And I ended up working for Quaker Fabrics here in the city. At one time, it was the largest employer in the city. I was a group leader in the finishing department. And during Bill Clinton's presidency, he lobbied to have China admitted into the World Trade Organization, and successfully. And I guess within 5-7 years of China being part of the World Trade Organization, my job in Quaker disappeared. And through federal and state aid, I was given the opportunity to be retrained for the workforce right here at BCC, and thank God, because I was a 55-year-old man with a high school education with no job. I was very fortunate that I didn't have more bills. But coming here was an unbelievable blessing. I feel kind of bad for the younger students who are here, because you guys just, you know, you've been exposed to school. For someone who, you know, like went to high school and then worked for in excess of 30 years in a manufacturing facility, and then have the opportunity to go back to school to be re-educated. You know, when I was like in the sixth grade, seventh grade, science, you know, states of matter, it was, you know, solid, liquid, gas. You know, that's the universe, you know. And then come back to BCC and take a chemistry course with Dr. James Pelletier and find out that the aurora borealis, the plasma that's causing that, is a state of matter as unique as solid and liquid. And that more dense than solid is Bose-Einstein condensate, fermionic condensate, and the proposed hypothetical zero phase. This is the universe. This is big. I mean, it's big. I mean, it was just an amazing experience. So, very quickly, I would encourage all of you to be as completely engaged at BCC as you possibly can. Service learning opportunities, civic engagement, community service. I was a student ambassador too. I just did it because I was offered the opportunity. I could not believe what the school did for me in that area. They send you away to a conference every year. It's just, it's like this invisible dome of opportunity and hope and fulfillment here, you know, and which is so different from the rest of the of Fall River, you know. So I would also, you know, Megan was talking about networking. It might be a good idea to consider all of yourselves as brothers and sisters in this engineering course and try to support each other in, you know, making your way through the school with the best grades that you can. If you feel, in my case, I was apprehensive about chemistry, so I asked my fellow students, well, you know, who is a good teacher for chemistry? And, you know, I got to meet Dr. Pelletier, who is now, I have heroes here, and Dr. Pelletier is one of them. And when it came to taking hard courses or being apprehensive about courses of study, the networking and finding out who other students recommended, when it came down to testing or studying, I made it a point to make sure I got sleep. And when I was studying, I, you know, kept myself caffeinated, and my magic food was chocolate. You know, some kind of chocolate thing, and, you know, it just kept me going. So, my job, I'm a blue-collar wastewater operator at the Fall River Wastewater Treatment Plant on Bay Street. The plant is managed by Veolia Water, which is an international company based in France. My paycheck is from Veolia Water in North America. What we do is we take water from the sewer system in Fall River, which we call an interceptor, that's a civil engineering term, and also from the combined sewer overflow tunnel, which is a 19-foot wide tunnel which is buried beneath Fall River. And those are the two sources of our influent that come into the plant. and we initially screen the sewer water, wastewater, to remove large debris. And next step, we send it into a grit chamber where we slow down the flow and allow the heavier particles to sink. And after that, most of the processes are just putting the wastewater into circular, large circular clarifiers and removing the stuff that sinks to the bottom and removing the stuff that floats to the top. We do that a couple of times in the process. We also aerate our flow to promote the growth of aerobic microbes, just like Brian was speaking. Our aerobic reactor is an important part of our process, because once we remove the significant size debris, there are still small food particles and microbes in the flow, and we want to encourage the microbes to reproduce, and they will eventually eat the organic material, and they themselves will sink to the bottom and be removed as sludge. So the stuff that sinks is sludge, the stuff that floats is scum, and we remove that as much as we can during the operation. After secondary clarification, we apply a disinfectant to the water. In our case, we use sodium hypochlorite, which is bleach, and we send it through a contact tank. The reason we call it a contact tank is the contact of the disinfectant with the wastewater, and the detention time as the wastewater and bleach is interacting affects our disinfection. We don't sterilize the water, but we remove enough pathogens, microbes, from the water so that the final product will not affect our receiving waters in a negative way. We send our effluent, what we treat, out into Mount Hope Bay. And during the course, I've been there, I'm looking at my fifth year now, but the area of the bay that is open to shell fishing has been expanded while I've been down there, which is a great thing. We've had the EPA down there for a week, and they've done testing where they put dyes out in the bay and check the flow of the tides and stuff like that. So particular jobs within the facility, I've kind of described roughly what the process is. But we have basically, like, for operators, two jobs. One is called the walk, where you're out on the facility is almost 14 acres in size. So the walk would involve monitoring equipment, make sure that everything is running properly, look at composite samplers that are sampling the wastewater, monitor gauges, make sure, like I said, pumps are on, and also take chlorine residuals on our final flow three times per shift, and to make sure that it's within limits. We want enough application of sodium hypochlorite to kill the pathogens, but not so much to negatively affect life in the bay. So we work within tolerance there. We also monitor amounts of sludge in clarifiers. We call those depth of blanket, DOBs, and monitor dissolved oxygen in our reactor. Our reactor is not, we don't get oxygen from algae. We go old school with huge technology. It is a positive swing adsorption device which provides oxygen to our reactors. Much of the equipment is underground, so to eliminate odors, but clarifiers and some buildings where there are odors, we vent the atmospheres to three odor scrubbers on site We're kind of in the middle of a residential neighborhood. So there are, I think that's pretty much it. So thank you very much.
So, do we have any questions for Tanya or for Dell at this point? Oh, come on. You know you want to ask Tanya something crazy about skydiving.
With a fish.
All right. I know some folks need to go on to class at 11 o'clock, so feel free if you have to leave, but we will then go ahead and bring Chris up now. And then we will be staying after 11, so if you do want to stay and talk with any of us and ask questions, don't hesitate. Chris, why don't you come on up? And then we'll just wait until the...
Thank you, Megan. You've all been very attentive, so I will try and be brief and as interesting as possible. One thing I did notice as I listened to the other speakers is that when we were young, we kind of came from the same place. You hear a lot of talk about people love being outside and doing outdoor things and being out in the environment. When I was in high school, I sort of knew I wanted to be an engineer, but I wasn't sure what kind of engineer I wanted to be. So I was thinking, do I want to be an electrical engineer? Do I want to be a mechanical engineer? And I was looking for brochures from different colleges, and they were showing their lab facilities and their computers. And then I'd come to the civil engineering department. And just about every promotional brochure for a civil engineering department, they would show their students out on the quad or out of the lawn with a surveying instrument. And they were doing their surveying labs, and they were learning how to survey. Or they would be out, you know, doing some river flow studies or that kind of thing. And I thought, hey, this is great, man. I love being outside. If I become a civil engineer, I'll be able to be outside and do all that stuff. So that's what attracted me to the field of civil engineering. And I went on to I started at what was then the University of Lowell and graduated from what is now UMass Lowell with a degree in civil engineering. This was in 1992. So now most of your degrees are in civil and environmental engineering. For me, I was interested in environmental. Environmental engineering didn't exist as a separate discipline at that time, so I have a degree in civil engineering. My early career, again, I enjoyed doing the environmental work, so I got involved in environmental engineering. So this was back in the early 90s, and hazardous waste site cleanup was sort of the big thing that was going on in the 80s and 90s. So we'd find contaminated waste sites, chemical plants, petroleum facilities, that kind of thing, where some kind of nasty chemical leaked into the ground and we'd excavate it, clean the water, and that kind of thing. So again, this was relatively recently after Superfund became a thing. You heard about Superfund sites and all this stuff. I did a lot of work. I worked for an environmental consulting firm, and we did a lot of work for the petroleum companies, mostly doing tank removals and cleanups of old gas stations. So I used to joke that I learned my way through all of New England by going from old gas station to old gas station. I knew where all the old gas stations were. So I sort of enjoyed that. One thing about engineering, any sort of technology-based discipline in this, I think even people in science will say this, it changes all the time. So for example, there are only a finite number of old gas stations out there to clean up. And by the end of the 90s, most of them had either been cleaned up or remediated or taken care of in one way or the other. So the field of environmental engineering changed. It went from these cleaning up of sites to regulatory compliance. You would come to, I did some work, we would go to a facility and sort of audit them for environmental compliance, see how they're storing their hazardous waste, how they're handling their materials, making sure everything is being done up to federal regulations. And so while, I had sort of in environmental engineering, you would kind of bounce back and forth between technology and compliance and other things like that. I was working for a company out of their office in East Providence, Rhode Island, and we did a lot of work near Narragansett Bay. And I really loved Narragansett Bay. I thought it was great. So I knew a lot of my colleagues that were going for master's degrees, and I was thinking, hey, maybe I should look into going in, for a master's degree. And again, going through different college brochures, I saw, I like being an engineer. I wanted a master's degree in engineering. And I saw that the University of Rhode Island had a great ocean engineering program, and their campus was located right on Narragansett Bay. And I thought, man, this is great. So I went there as a full-time student. and studied, as a civil engineer, I get interested in ocean wave mechanics, the physics of ocean waves, coastal and offshore structural design, and I took some course in ocean instrumentation. I actually took one course in ocean instrumentation because I needed that to fill out my curriculum. I just needed 3 credits, so I took it. I wasn't an electrical engineer, not that into it. I thought I was just going to be a straight-up coastal engineer because I love coastal engineering. So I graduated, I got my degree. I spent some more time, a couple more years in environmental consulting, doing some more actually environmental work. Again, the environmental background and engineering served me very well. I did some waterfront work, and then a job opportunity opened up at the UMass Dartmouth School for Marine Science and Technology in New Bedford. They were looking for an engineer actually to help them do some data analysis. The one nice thing about engineering degrees, and if you're going to get an engineering degree, I can't recommend it enough, is that you learn a lot of math. You learn how to do math. And being able to do math is something that is always in demand. You know how to do math, you know how to work hard, and you can solve problems. So just about any employer likes that combination. So I started off doing some data analysis, doing some statistical analysis of some, I think it was fishery data, you know, back in the early 2000s. And then the university had gotten a grant for helping to develop some new technologies. Now, the nice thing was, I mean, it was a great place to work. There were, you know, all these professors, there were tons of scientists everywhere. I was basically the only engineer in the whole building. So luckily for me, we deal with all these new technologies, and every time some sort of new toy or something would come in, it's like, oh, Chris, he's an engineer. We'll let him work on that. So I sort of worked it into, I was basically providing technical support for a lot of these science professors. One thing to note, science and technology, especially as a major, are often used interchangeably, and they are related, and scientists and engineers do work together. There is kind of a key difference between what a scientist does and what an engineer does. So I used to say, you know, I'd be working on a project where we'd be using an autonomous underwater glider to study ocean currents. And I said, well, a scientist, he knows all about the ocean currents. He knows about the ocean, he knows all about this stuff. As an engineer, I kind of know about the ocean, but I really know about that underwater glider that we're using to detect these currents. So for me, like I said, engineers work with the technology. So the scientists go for the why behind processes, you know, natural, physical, whatever. An engineer works on the technology, the actual machines, the computers, the mechanical and electrical things that scientists use to do their job. So I did that for probably a dozen years. Again, grant funded. Anybody, you guys aren't totally in the academic world yet, but I know there are a number of people up here who have been grant funded, knows that that's not always that stable. I mean, my grant is actually still going. Then I had an opportunity, came up with the Mass Department of Transportation out of their office in Taunton in their construction division. So I actually now work on highway and bridge construction, doing project oversight and management, making sure that roads and bridges are constructed up to specification and according to design, make sure that the job is run safely, everyone's paid for what they've done and they aren't paid for what they didn't do. So I'm a little more of an administrator now, but again, that's, as an engineer, as you move up, that's kind of what you end up doing. So you do less of the design work, but more of that kind of thing. A couple more things, like I said, generally about engineering. One thing I have found, so that's a real thumbnail sketch about what I've done. I've actually done all kinds of interesting things, but they've all been related to engineering. The nice thing about an engineering degree is engineering is a vast, vast, vast field of study. Essentially, if you look around this room, everything in here was designed by an engineer and probably a different type of engineer. The slope of those stairs, those handrails are designed to be at a certain slope and take a certain load. Those lights, you know, the light bulbs were designed by engineers. The electrical system powering the lights was designed by an engineer. This microphone, everything was designed by some kind of engineer. So when you study engineering, you're never going to learn everything that you need to know in school. So what your background in engineering is going to teach you is how to solve problems. And that's what will serve you well. That served me well. Most of the stuff I've done as a professional was not something I learned in school, but it's something that, using my background, I've been able to figure out. So that's my little soapbox about engineering. One thing people did mention a lot of is networking. And again, I can't stress this enough. I heard this talk when I was a student. I didn't listen, but I'm hoping you guys will. I have been, I'm the past president of both the Rhode Island section of the American Society of Civil Engineers and the New England section of the Marine Technology Society. Those are both professional societies where people in their individual disciplines, you know, go to and get together. A lot of times they'll have meetings, they'll have events. Dinner meetings are always popular. They'll have a dinner and they'll have a speaker to talk about some topic. But what it is people in the industry like to get together and network and talk. And what they love to see are students at these things. So you know, I mean, if you're a civil engineer, look up, you know, American Society of Civil Engineers. It's very easy now. There's the internet, there's LinkedIn, there's Facebook, there's all kinds of stuff. Find out when the local chapters are having some kind of event. To encourage students, a lot of times they'll be free or almost free, and you usually end up with a free meal out of it. But the more important thing is you can learn something from a speaker talking, but the most important thing is all these people from the industry are going to be there, and you get to interact with them in a social setting. You're not asking them for a job. You're not asking them for anything. You could be talking about how great it is that Tom Brady is back playing for the Patriots now. So you're just socializing, and they get to know you. So what happens, next year you're applying for a job. They see 100 resumes come into their, I used to say on their desk, but probably in their inbox. They don't know who 99 of those people are, but they're like, oh, I remember that guy. I talked to him at that, you know, ASCE meeting last year. So you automatically, you're kind of friends with them already. So, and just the more you do it, the more they recognize your face, and they're more likely to hire someone they know rather than someone they don't know. You know, qualifications aside, it's like anybody. If you're friends with somebody, you want to help them out. So they may even find a spot for you if they like you. So again, everyone stresses networking, but again, I hope you listen to it. I didn't when I was your age or, you know, back in school, but serving as an officer in those organizations, I would definitely recommend it. And I know a lot of times the Marine Technology Society, if you're interested in marine technology stuff, a lot of their events are right here in Fall River, so you don't have far to go.
We have a few more minutes, so now I'll open the panel up to anybody. So if you have questions for Chris, Dell, Tanya, Linton, or Brian, now would be a great time to ask them. If you would prefer, we can also just kind of wrap it up here in a minute, and you guys can talk to them individually. But does anybody have a question? Don't be shy. All right. Well, in that case, let me go ahead and say a few closing words. First off, I want to thank our panel very much. I know that, again, it's not always easy for you folks to leave work, so we appreciate your time and energy. And especially for our students, it's a great opportunity for them to hear directly from industry folks. So, again, thank you so much for your time. And then last but not least, just as we were talking, I just want to reinforce that we have several programs here at BCC. So if you are thinking that you might be interested in environmental sciences or environmental technology, you might be wanting to do a biology degree, you are interested in engineering, we offer these programs here at BCC. Also, we offer specific certificates, and our wastewater drinking water is one of those certificates. So if those are things that are of interest to you, I'm more than happy to talk to you about that after the event today. And with that, I'm going to thank everybody, and a round of applause for our panelists. Thank you so much. And so if you guys would like to come down and talk with them individually and ask questions, that would be great.